that they thou appear not unto men of fact, but unto thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which is in secret shall reward thee openly. So we have the same instructions when it comes to fasting as we do to prayer, as given in the Sermon on the Mount. What did Jesus say about those that pray openly for attention? They have the reward right there. If you fast, Jesus is saying, don't fast openly, because if you're just seeking attention, you're going to get it. You already have your reward. But when, rather, when you fast, if you're serious about it, do it in a way that no one else really knows it. Don't make it public. Don't go announcing it from the rooftop. But keep it private between you and your Father. And don't be prideful about your fasting. We find that in Luke chapter 18, verse 10 through 14. We were just alluding to this. Two men went up into the temple to pray, the one a Pharisee and the other a publican. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as a publican. I fast twice in the week, I give tithes of all that I possess. And the publican standing afar off would not lift up so much his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down into his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. So just reiterating, when we fast, a fast is not between us and everyone else. Fast is between us and God. If a church has a public fast day, that's one thing. Everybody know you're fasting? That's fine. But don't go making announcements. You know, you go on Facebook and everybody has a picture of this is what I'm having for lunch and this is where I went, this and that. Don't have a selfie of you sitting down, kneeling, praying in with a food, with a plate covered and saying, I'm not fasting today. You already have your reward. I know that's a little far-fetched out there for, but it's between us and God. A fast is between us and God. It's between nobody else. When it comes to our relationship with God, our relationship is between us and God. We can't make anybody else get right with God. We can't force it into it, but we can make sure that we're right with God. When it comes to fasting, we may not be able to make anybody else pray and fast, but we can make sure that we are praying and fasting. We have control over ourselves, and when it comes down to it, our prayer life and our fastings, they're all before God. They're for Him and Him alone. In Matthew chapter 9, verse 14 through 15, the Bible states, then came to Him the disciples of John, saying, why do we and the Pharisees fast often, but the disciples fast not? And Jesus said unto them, can the children of the bride chamber mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? For the days will come when the bridegroom shall be taken from them, and they shall fast. As long as Jesus was there, the disciples didn't really have any need to fast. He was right there in their midst. And when He wasn't exactly in their midst, He was right with them in even the harshest situations. That time they were alone on the boat, they just got back from seeing Legion being cast out from the man of the Gadarenes. And what happens? A storm arises on the Sea of Galilee. Jesus wasn't with them because He stayed back to pray on a hilltop. But when the winds and everything was unbearable and coming on around them, Jesus shows up. When they're going across the sea and a storm arises, Jesus is in the boat sleeping with them. They didn't know what to do, which way to rise. But Jesus was right there with them and He handled the situation. As long as they were with Christ, they didn't have any need to fast. But Jesus is ascended to the right hand of the Father, and He goes to the Father on our behalf. If we really want to see something done, we need to fast to show Him our seriousness and submit this flesh that the spiritual man might rise up. Because we know that there is constantly that war between the carnal man and the spiritual man. And as long as we are taking breath on this earth, it doesn't matter how spiritual any of us ever get. But there's always going to be that struggle because as a result of Adam's sin, that carnal man has been integrated into us. And we can subdue him, but he's always going to be there struggling and fighting against us. And when we look at fasting, you should be accompanied by prayer and also Bible reading. If we look at Isaiah 58, Jeremiah 14, 12, and for the sake of time, we won't return to all the passages. You have them in your notes. But fasting needs to be accompanied closely by prayer and Bible reading. Because if we fast by itself, say, God, I'm going to fast today for lunch. But if all we do is skip eating, and we don't pray, and we don't read our Bible, it's nothing but a diet. We haven't done anything to really draw closer to God. Fasting is when we stop eating or set something aside, and we replace it by something that's going to draw us close to God, whether it's prayer, whether it's Bible reading. If we do not accompany it with any of those, it is just a diet. Like I said, in place of eating, we need to go to God in prayer and fasting. I'm getting ready to close up here. It's in those times, like I said, it shows God that we're serious about our desires. We're serious about what we want. It's one thing to pray for something, but when we fast, we are showing to God that we really want Him to move in this situation. And if we are really going to fast, even if it's more than just a meal, if we're going to fast a day, 2 days, 3 days, a week, whatever it is, when we feel that hunger arising, we really need to find ourselves a place of prayer. Because we're going to get intimate with God. And I promise you, it will subdue the desire to eat at that point. God will feed us with that spiritual manna. If you feel hungry and you have the opportunity, pray. Why do I say if you have the opportunity? Because some of us do work jobs, and if I'm in the middle of riding out of a car and I'm fasting and I get hungry, I can't just drop everything and go off into the field and back behind Walmart and pray. It's not possible.
Why not?
You talk to Walmart. You've been there. You know how it's run.
Break time. In
Cornfield. Yes. And I've done that already. You find yourself a place of prayer when possible. But if you have the opportunity when you're hungry and you feel it arising, head off and pray. And there is no wrong time frame for fasting, and there's no wrong time for fasting. When we look at time frames, some people might say, well, you have to fast for X number of days or X number of meals. There's no time given when it comes to the Bible. We know that David fasted for 1 day. The early church fasted 2 days a week. They fasted on Wednesdays. They fasted on Fridays. We know in Esther chapter 4 and 16 that they fasted for 3 days and three nights. Acts chapter 10, 10 and 31. Cornelius fasted for 4 days. In 1 Samuel chapter 31, verse 13, they fasted for 7 days. In the book of Acts 27, they fasted for 14 days. Daniel chapter 10. Daniel fasted for 21 days. We know that Moses was on Mount Sinai. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. Jesus in the wilderness. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. The Bible does not give a time frame that says, brother or sister so-and-so, you must fast for this number of days and that's it. There's no time limit. But the time limit will be determined by how serious we are with God. Or how many times we fast. I realize some people, for health reasons, they might have to eat this, that, whatever it is. You know your relationship with God. Fasting is taking us a step farther than prayer and showing God that we are serious about what we desire. That we are submitting this flesh and putting it and subduing it, that we may receive an answer from heaven. It is a commitment between us and God. And it is not something to take lightly. We'll talk about that next week. When it comes to fasting, if you tell God that you're going to fast for breakfast, you better fast for breakfast. You made a commitment before God. And God holds commitments in high regard. Any vow you make to God, keep it. Don't tell God you're going to fast all day tomorrow if you're not going to fast all day tomorrow. Does anybody have any thoughts, any questions, anything they want to add? I know this isn't a new topic, but if we are truly going to become a Pentecostal powerhouse, if we are truly going to see God move in our life, it's going to come when we step outside of our comfort zone. Step out in faith, step out more in prayer, step out more in fasting. Let us bow our heads and prepare our hearts for service. Gracious Heavenly Father, we give you all praise and glory for everything you've done for us and shall continue to do. Lord, we thank you that your God reigns on high and that there is none like you, Lord. Even right now, we rebuke every attack of the enemy that should come our way. We pray that you set your angels by the four corners of the property above and below, that no attack may penetrate. I pray that our hearts and our minds would be in one mindset and one accord, that we may worship you in sincerity and truth, and the Holy Ghost may move, making himself visible however he chooses, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you anoint the ministers today and on the song leader and the musicians as they lead us in the songs you have us to sing, as they praise you upon the string instruments and the vocal cords, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you anoint Brother David as he brings forth your message this morning, anoint his mind and his lips to bring forth your words today, Lord. I pray, Lord, that our hearts and minds will be good soil for your word to fall on, that we may remember it throughout the week. But even greater than that, that we would apply it to our lives, Lord. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.